universal language, right? Now, when I was this tiny kid, I remember I went to this inter-school music competition, and there were these five distinct categories of music that I clearly remember. There was Hindustani music, there was Carnatic Sangeet, there was Western music, you had Sugam Sangeet, and then you had Robindra Sangeet. That was when this tiny Anuja, for the first time, she asked this question. If music is truly universal, then why do we have these categories, no? Why do we feel that some music sounds Hindustani or some music sounds Western? What is that it? What is that element that gives music its identity? As an 8-year-old, my logic was pretty simple. If the song is in English, then it's Western. If the song is in Hindi, then it's Hindustani. If it's in Tamil, Telugu, then it's Carnatic. If it's Marathi, then it's Sugam Sangeet. And if it's in Bengali, then Robindra Sangeet. As simple as that, I thought. But is it really that simple? Let's verify this claim a little. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to make you all listen and I'm going to sing. So I'll be singing for you all a piece in English. And according to the logic that we discussed, it should sound Western to your ears, right? But you tell me if it's sounding Western, okay? Here you go. Come on, turn the radio on. It's Friday night and I won't be long. Gotta do my hair, put my makeup on. It's Friday night and I won't be long. And I won't be long. And I won't be long. Did it sound Western?
Thank you, thank you.
No, right? Hopefully no. Let's verify this claim again. And this time, I'll sing in front of y'all a piece which is composed in Braja Bhasha. Now, some of y'all might not know, or maybe many of y'all might not know, that Braja Bhasha is a northern, North Indian dialect, and it's used in the compositions or bandishes of Hindustani music. So according to the logic, it should sound Hindustani. You tell me if it's sounding Hindustani. Thank you again. So, well, at this point, we can safely claim that the element that gives music its identity somewhere goes beyond the language of composition of the musical piece. Will you all agree? Okay. Then what is it? I must confess at this point that I have grown up as a singer, and so I have been a little biased towards vocal music. But as you all know, music is not just singing or it's not just vocal music. It has pure instrumentation also. It has instrumental music. So at a point of time, I thought, you know, it's the instrumentation. The instruments used that give music its identity. You know, guitar is equal to Western music and sitar is equal to Indian music, as simple as that. But again, we are going to have a listening exercise and we are going to verify this claim. Are you all prepared?
Yes.
Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to play two audios, pure instrumental audios, and I'm sure that both will give you all two distinct regional flavors. Okay? So could we have the first audio, please?
Thank you.
a Spanish music for y'all. And now the second audio, please. This was, I think the lady guessed it, it's Carnatic music, right? So see, two distinct flavors, our regional flavors. But you know, there was a common thread. And what was it? Both the tunes were played on the very same instrument. That is the electric guitar. So generally, when someone, you know, mentions electric guitar, what comes in my mind is rock music and metal. But can you believe this? It's so fascinating that the same electric guitar gave you the feel of Spanish flamenco kind of music and traditional art music of India, Carnatic music. So now can we state that the element that gives music its identity somewhere goes beyond instrumentation itself, right? What is it? Is it the tune? Is it the set of musical notes used? Now in India, we are told that, you know, learn English, because it's a relatively global language and wherever you go, you'll be able to communicate. True that. So I'll take the example of English to demonstrate my point. D-A-U-G-H-T-E-R, this word, it's made up of letters, set of letters. Give it to an Indian and they would pronounce it as daughter. Give it to someone in America, and the American pronunciation would probably be daughter. Give it to someone in Britain, and the pronunciation would be daughter, right? The same language, the same word, the same set of letters. But what made the difference? The accent, right? Even in music, you can have the same tune or the same set of notes. Say, da ra 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 ra. Give it to a Hindustani musician and they would interpret it as sa re ga pa da sa. Give it to a Carnatic musician, the interpretation I'll try probably would be sa re ga pa da sa. And give it to a Western pop musician and the probable interpretation would be shubhra-ba-du-ba, right? Okay, so what made the difference? What made the difference? It was the way in which the tune was approached, the way in which the notes were pronounced. In language, that's accent, and in music, it's called, we can term it as musical intonation. Again, at this point, let me just clarify that the 8-year-old Anuja was not completely wrong. The language of composition does play a role in giving music its identity. So does the instrumentation, so does the tune, the set of notes, and the rhythmic patterns, and so many other factors. They all go hand in hand. And they also go hand in hand with the intonation. But why am I emphasizing on intonation so much? Because this factor is taken for granted even by us musicians. So I just wanted to highlight it in this talk. This being said, a few days ago, I was listening to this gypsy music from the area of Turkey, Iran, Afghanistan, you know, that belt. And something very peculiar about their intonation hit my ears. They use this very, very unique embellishment or ornamentation in their tune. Let me try to demonstrate. Na 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 sheikh? That sheikh is a typical ornament from that region, the gypsy music of that region. Now, when you aspire or when you are a music composer and you are aiming to compose songs or compose the background or compose the music for a film or for theater, that is the time when you have to have a little generalistic approach. And you, for that, you need to know various types of music. And there was this movie that released in India in 1961, if I'm not wrong. It's called Kabuliwala. And in that movie, the protagonist is a native from Afghanistan who's come settled in India. And he, at a point of time, remembers his motherland. Salil Chaudhary ji, who was the music composer, he had to compose a song. And he very smartly used the instrumentation, the native instrument of that land, the rabab. But at the same time, you know what? He did not forget this shaky intonation. And he used that to give the additional flavor. See, just demonstrating the song. Tu hi meri aarzu, tu hi meri aabru, tu hi meri jaan. Maa ka dil ban ke kabhi seene se lag jata hai tu. You saw that? That piece? He could have taken it plainly. Maa ka dil ban ke kabhi seene. But no, he took that shake. Kabhi seene. And that, somewhere that transported you to that region of Afghanistan. See, I didn't use the rabab anywhere. But even without the instrumentation and just the intonation, you got the flavor. Didn't you?
Yes. Yeah.
So that's, I think, thank you. I think the credit goes to the music composer for his brilliance. That's the beauty of intonation. Well, sometimes I wonder, I get this thought in my mind, that is there a hack to learn music? Is there a specific way to approach or learn music in a specific manner, you know, for brilliance, for excellence? That's what people are chasing, no, these days. First thing, when we grew up as students of music, many people, they came and told us, you know what you need to do? Learn Hindustani or learn Carnatic. Basically, learn Indian classical music. And after you master that, you will be able to sing any genre in the world. Don't worry about that. But when someone says this to you, you need to take it with a pinch of salt. Because as I'm exploring music now, I think I have a long way to go, of course. But I'm realizing that each type of music, each genre, each category has its own aesthetics, has its own beauty. And I'm not just talking about the intonation. Intonation somewhere is, you'll realize when you delve deeper, that it's just the surface. It's a very shallow way of looking at music. Each type of music has its own grammar, its own literature, and somewhere it represents its own philosophy. And the second thing that I wanted to say is that, you know, as children, when we grow up, many of you might be able to relate to this. We were made to sing to impress or perform to impress. First, our relatives, then the examiners in the music exam, then the judges of the music competition, then the audience for votes. So it's very hardwired, this impressing business. But we musicians somewhere, we need to inspire the budding generation of music practitioners, and we need to tell them, hey, listen, don't use music as a medium to impress. Rather, use it as a medium to express. Because, you know what? The speech is not yet done. Music is not just about the skill set, right? We need to learn the skill. Yes, it's very important. But it's an art form, ultimately. And the art will flourish only with your heart. So I would like to say that ultimately, essentially, what, according to me, gives music its true identity is your intention and is your emotion. So thank you.